I said, I think you're AD.
It's quite possible. What does AD mean? You're probably thinking. Mm-hmm. Well, AD is a sensory preference, and today we are going to teach you about sensory preferences and how you can use them to manifest magic in your relationships.
Yes. Ooh, I like that. Manifest magic.
Hi, my name is Dr. Assael Romanelli.
And I'm Galit Romanelli.
And this is the
Potential State.
And today we're going to talk about sensory preferences, your idiosyncratic map to the world. This comes from the world of NLP, neurolinguistic programming, which basically says we do not react to the world. We react to our map of the world, which is based on the way we intake the senses, our sensory intake of the world.
Yes, how we codify it, how we make sense of things.
And we will now describe to you briefly each one of the sensory preferences.
Four.
And then we will give you examples and tips how to work with them. So the first one is V, visual. So people that are visual, first of all, they will dress aesthetically.
Yeah, usually they're like very put together.
Their office is organized. Their desk is organized.
Everything looks really nice and good and everything's in place. You know those people who kind of like a slight change in the way they're kind of... I don't know, something on their desk is. I can't think of anything in particular, but like I have a lot of different stuff on my desk. So like, you know, the kind of people that notice if it's like slightly off and it really will irk them and so they'll fix it. That's V.
And they also learn from seeing. They learn from sight. So they're fast learners, not necessarily...
Kind of photographic memory,
exactly,
almost.
Exactly. And they'll use metaphors and their language will be full of visual metaphors.
For instance, can you see it? I can see the vision.
It's a bit blurry for me, what you're talking about.
Right. Right?
So that's visual. The next is kinesthetic, or K, which is about body and feeling.
Yes.
So it can be either the physical K, exercise, movement, or it can be the feeling K.
Emotions
going
where
in.
Where we feel it in the body. These are people who kind of speak a lot about how, ooh, that meeting felt, I felt good about that.
Yeah.
That felt like it went well. Or I got a bad feeling about that experience that didn't jive with me so well.
Right. And they'll dress for comfort. They'll touch things. They'll move around a bit.
Oh yeah, they'll touch things. I do that.
Right.
They'll
usually the house will be disorganized, but it will be comfortable. They'll know everything where everything is. They'll say it's organized in my way. If someone says that to you, they're probably kinesthetic. The next one is A, auditory. Auditory are people that their strong sense is their ears. They usually have symmetrical body languages. They usually lean to their strong ear. Their eyes will go right and left. And usually they have a very kind of melodic speech. They like books, music, they play. They're usually musicians.
Yeah, they have like a good ear for music.
Or lecturers, authors, clergy.
And the words really matter.
Right.
The words that you use really matter.
Exactly. And it's really important for them to finish sentences to be heard.
We'll get to that.
And their metaphors are going to be auditory metaphors. For instance, this didn't sound right.
Nice. Good one.
Can't hear it. You're not hearing me. Mm. And the last sensory preference is called audio digital, which actually...
Logic. Everything has to make sense.
Right.
The beautiful Excel spreadsheets.
Right.
Right?
Right. Usually they don't
make so much
eye contact, kind of a monotonic speech.
Right. Like before, when we were getting organized and I was just like flying off and improvising, I was like, no, this is not according to the script.
Right.
This is not kind of built out. You're just like, you're going all over the place.
Right.
Clearly, I am less of an AD.
Exactly. So in NLP, they talk about the primary and the secondary, the one we were born with and the secondary one we've kind of adopted or we grew up into. So each one of us has a primary and secondary. So for instance, for me, I'm a big kinesthetic, feeling, body, touch. And my secondary is A, books, music, singing. And I also have a very strong AD because I need to be in control.
Right. So obviously you have a range of
right.
four with primary and secondary as kind of your go-tos. Obviously, because that's
what's your sensory preferences?
So it's really interesting because for a very long time I thought my primary was V, but actually I think I'm coming to realize that my primary is K. I'm much more kind of I rely on how I feel about things. Sometimes it's kind of a gut. I do like to touch a lot, and yeah, how else? It's emotion. You know, how do things land for me? So I think recently it's kind of become clear to me that it's more K and V. Still Still V.
So each preference is great. It's not that one's better than the other. And they're influenced also by my natural, my innate preference, but also the environment. So if I grew up, my brother, for instance, is very visual, but he grew up in a kinesthetic home. Mm. So his visual was stinted a little bit, while his K was more amplified. So you're actually being influenced by the environment. And the whole idea is that the more versed you are in different sensory preferences, the easier it is for you to communicate.
Right.
Because not everyone's going to have your same sensory preference.
So that's preference. Like, I like to kind of equate that to learning another language, right? So when you know another language, you can identify what language these other people are speaking, and then you can start to relate to them in their language, and then the communication is better.
Let me give you an example from the clinic. I once worked with a man. He was a big auditory and his wife was a big K. And he insisted, he came with lists every single week of things he wanted to talk about. Mm. And if you'd cut him in the middle, he'd be insulted and he'd go back to the beginning of the list. Mm. But his wife was a K. She wasn't even listening to the word. She was going with the feeling. Mm. And a lot of their clash and their tension was the AK clash. Mm. In every single couple I work with, I teach this, because oftentimes in the root of a lot of couples' communication problems are just different sensory preferences. They are experiencing the world different.
Right.
The world of
They're
an auditory.
They're codifying the world differently.
Exactly.
Right. So one time, can I give my example?
Please.
You in the middle.
No, yeah. Go for it.
So one time I had a similar instance where I was working with someone who was an A, and I kept, you know, if I because I'm kind of a case, so sometimes when I have an idea, I just like immediately interrupt and I want it, it bursts out of me. So I kept interrupting and I couldn't understand why he was getting really frustrated with me. And he would just kind of plow through. It was like a bulldozer. Like he would just continue to say his sentences regardless. And then when I realized that he's an A and it's really important for, you know, the full sentence and for him to be able to complete it, and he wasn't able to kind of navigate around my interruptions or things like that. He had to complete the full, and at first I thought it was kind of like him being dismissive of me. But when I realized that this is how he codifies and expresses, you know, his experience of the world, then I was able, A, to realize that I needed to tone down my interruptions, and B, he wasn't doing it to dismiss me. He genuinely had to finish the sentence in order to kind of move on to the next thought, move on to the next stage.
And another example is we taught this language to our kids because we realized that Tzach, our son, is a very big kinesthetic. And when he was looking for that kinesthetic touch, that kinesthetic parenting, and when we were talking about this, we realized there was a gap sometimes between Galit's K and Tzach's K. And what happens is, in the beginning, we didn't know how to really communicate that. But once we had this terminology, we could help explain to him that his need for K, we could satisfy that need sometimes. But sometimes we'd actually teach him the differences between those different types of K.
Right.
So as you can see, the second you have this terminology, go on.
No, and I want to say that I think especially with children, but not just, it's really important to be careful of not labeling, right? There's a difference between kind of identifying our preferences and labeling. And I think that especially with children, because they're growing and evolving and these sensory preferences can change, that we kind of give space to flexibility, give the language and allow them. And this is true also of partners, because through our conversations, we have moved away from various sensory preferences and been able to kind of say, well, actually, I think I'm more of a, you know, when we started dating, you thought you were a V, which is just ridiculous because he's not at all.
I'm not visual.
But, and so, you know, none of this is meant to be kind of rigid and this is what you are and that's it. It's in order to enable a deeper level of conversation and understand, like sometimes we'll have a conversation and I'll say, Assael, listen to my K. Like, what is my K telling you? And I know that because we both share that, he can tap into that. And it doesn't matter if I don't get the words exactly right. He can get the emotion that I'm trying to express.
So here are some tips how to do this. So first, reflect what's your primary and secondary preferences. You can listen to this video again or listen to this talk again. And then try to write that down. Even just write K-A or A-A-D, whatever that is. Also, choose the people around you. Okay. Also, your partner, friends, colleagues, even your kids.
And also notice kind of what kind of language do you use to describe things? Do you use a lot of visual metaphors to describe things? Or do you, you know, say things like, that feels right. Yeah, that feels good. You know, do you use more kind of language that reflects and indicates to a more K preference or an A preference?
And then choose to become more conscious of it. And when you're talking to these other people, A, you can share with them this episode, and kind of help them also assess themselves. But then be conscious of the sensory preference gap, because that's where you're going to find a lot of ruptures.
Miscommunication. Right, you're right. Speaking a different language.
And then what do you do? How do you, and then try to expand your sensory preference mastery. And how do you do that? So A's, when you're communicating with someone to A, speak slower, let them finish their sentences, repeat some of their words back to them. Make sure you've heard them properly.
Try and use their words back to them. Exactly. I noticed that helps a lot.
With visual people, you've got to respect their visual, the space. If there's clutter, they won't be able to work.
I can't start working if there's clutter. Exactly. I can't.
So you want to make sure the space is clean. You also want to use graphs. You want to draw it out. You want to help them see it.
Visual representation.
Okay. Versus with audio, right? It's the words. You want to write words on the whiteboard. Then you have K's. K's need space to move. They need to touch. K's also learn from doing it. V's learn from seeing it. A's
really
learn
important.
From reading it. K learns by doing
practice.
It.
Practice.
You need to practice it.
They
want to walk me through it.
What is that called when your body remembers?
Sensory memory? Somatic memory.
Yes. Somatic memory.
And audio digital people need explanation. They need to explain the logic.
You need to break it down.
Break it down to little chunks and explain the logic. So as you can see, and the more flexible you are, the more languages you can speak, because each one is a language. Refer to the love language episode.
Yeah.
The more you can speak in different languages, the more you'll be able to communicate with more people. And we've discovered that brilliance is someone that has...
That can tap into a lot of their sensory
that
preferences.
That has mastered
a
lot of sensory preferences.
Sometimes even all at once.
Exactly.
It's
so,
amazing.
Bottom line is
listen, watch the video. What's the bottom line?
Bottom line
I'm not
is
a mind sensor, reader.
Sensor, can't you read my mind?
No.
Sensory preferences, learn them, know which one you are, know which ones the people around you are. Be open minded in case those change over time.
Yes.
But what's important is the sensory, people are reacting to their map, not to reality. So, stop.
And not your map. That's
exactly,
the important part.
Exactly.
We all have our own map.
Exactly. So learn sensory.
And there's no judgment. There's no judgment.
There's no judgment.
It's not my map is better than your map. It's just here's my map. Here's the key to my map. Now we can communicate. I was having a hard time with
okay,
me.
Okay, so I hope you enjoy what you saw, heard, understood, and felt. And we will see you next time. This was Gilly Romanelli.
And Dr. Assael Romanelli.
And this was the
Potential State.